career pathway that we explored for this lesson was public safety, and we thought we would just take the idea of police officer, something within law enforcement. We know that San Bernardino High School has this pathway, so we want our kids to know they don't have to attend just the high school that's in our boundaries, but they can go to another high school, and that they would be excited to do something with public safety.
The students got hooked on this theme prior to school even starting. We had crime scene tape out in front of the room. We had the crime scene investigation truck out in the front. There was a police officer, full uniform, standing in the room. So right when we got the students, they came through the crime scene and they see this man standing there where there's a real live crime that had happened. My laptop was stolen from the Friday that we left all the way through the holiday weekend. Something happened to it. I left it at school. We trashed the desk, and the students walked into that and they believed it was real until the press conference.
Well, you guys have all been chosen because you show that you have an ability to help us out. You are gonna tell me and help me. I don't have any officers available right now. As you know, this, you live in this city, it's a very busy city. We have police officers busy everywhere. So what we're gonna do is, the laptop was here on this desk when it was last seen. And obviously, looks like somebody's been in here. I brought one of my ID techs. Her name is Rhonda.
It was very important to have the lieutenant from the police department as well as his ID tech so the students could see what the possibilities are out there.
I would take pictures showing all areas of it to show the condition of it that I found it. And then I'll do closer pictures of the actual scene and the areas of interest, like showing that this is ransacked. I'd show that the laptop is missing here.
So once we explained to them their job, what the lieutenant was doing here, and he spoke with them, then I think they really got hooked into the idea that they had a job to do and a problem to solve, and that they were responsible for that. And when you put responsibility on the students and your expectations are high, they all rise to meet it. The students that have trouble with discipline and tend to be disruptive in class, we had zero discipline problems this week because they were constantly engaged, and I think they felt they were responsible in their group to help each other, that no one had to do this by themselves, and they understood that they were tasked with something serious, and they really rose to the occasion. And I think just setting the scenario and engaging them and hooking them right away, that set the tone for the whole entire week, and they really rose to the occasion.
Once the students had logged all of their photograph pieces of evidence and every evidence that they had, or all the evidence that they had collected, the students actually read a scenario that described the prior days to the crime happening.
We wanted them to look at all the information and then do a sequence of events, a timeline. And in that timeline, they had to refer to five different sources, from different schedules, from office staff to custodian staff, who has a key to the room, video information, daily schedules, so they can compile all that information to deduce what happened and to come up with this timeline or sequence of events to understand when the crime could have occurred.
I put Mr. A came in at 4:25 and then asked a question.
No. On the third day in the afternoon, we created questions to interview our suspects. Prior to the kids actually asking the suspects, we also wanted to kind of talk about body language and how you can read that and kind of know what a person, what they're thinking and feeling inside just by observation, pure observation. This is a defense like mechanism that we just have. It's just nature to do this. You might do something with your hands. Thank you for raising your hand. KIJ?
Or you might do what you did earlier, curl your hair.
Okay, play with hair is one.
But a lot of people wouldn't do that.
Yeah, but it depends on the person. For me, if I'm nervous, then I play with my hair, and I don't know if anybody else does.
I play with my necklace. That's why I have necklace.
Okay. The part of questioning the suspects involved a lot of communication because it was verbal and nonverbal. So not only were they listening to what the suspects were saying and writing down the information, they were having to infer and deduce what they were saying. Is this a lie or is this a truth? Does this make sense with the evidence that I have? Or is this completely out of character for the person? Does it match anything that we have found? So they had to communicate not only with the suspect, then once again with each other, and again justify and provide evidence that this is why we're choosing this person based on what they've said and what we found to be true.
What shoes do you normally wear with your jeans?
When I wear jeans, Well, it depends. If I'm at work and I'm wearing jeans and I have like a dress shirt on, I'll still wear these shoes, same shoes I wear every other day to work.
No, like blue jeans?
Yeah. Sometimes I wear blue jeans to work if it's a day where I'm doing things that are more physical.
Okay. You know how you say you have tennis shoes, right?
Yeah, I have tennis shoes.
And I was wondering, what kind do you have?
Like, Skechers.
That'll be it for me.
Okay, thank you.
Look at Mr. Majors. Look how in the middle, how right here, it doesn't go all the way through because you would see the line through there.
But this one has this.
Yeah, and it doesn't have
he may that. Have, they may have been wearing different shoes.
That's what I was
you should ask what, how many pairs of shoes do you have?
Yeah, no.
Do you have it in your classroom?
Like, what kind
now
of shoes do you have? Oh, we should ask and show them the picture. Like, do you have
yeah,
shoes like this?
Does it match the bottom of these? But we didn't.
The students actually had to recreate a narrative based off of all the evidence and as well as the scenario and just everything that they had seen since they entered the crime scene. So we had started this prior to the lieutenant coming in, and then when the lieutenant got there, he actually got into our room. He read our students' police reports and started asking them other leading questions.
Let's start with what we talked about over there, and then we'll kind of go down. What kind of evidence do you have? You've just mentioned some stuff that was circumstantial stuff.
We have a shoe print, size 11 tennis shoe, Diet Coke bottle with fingerprints, open mint case with fingerprints also, south side of, oh, we didn't even by south side of essence class desk.
Do you think the fingerprints are a good comparison?
Two of them matched him.
Two of them matched him?
Yeah.
And were they... You got to figure, since he's a janitor, he's in here all the time, right?
Yeah.
So would he leave his fingerprints normally in this room? If
yeah.
Is that something that would happen on a regular basis?
Yeah. Welcome to the Binglong CSI press conference. On Tuesday, January 20th, 2015, at approximately 08:57 hours, we arrived at 1250 East 9th Street, San Bernardino, California, 92410 in E100.
So on the last day, it was kind of the culminating day of our project. So the students had decided who their main suspect was. It was our principal, Mr. Rainbolt. We brought back all of the suspects and they were seated in our press conference.
And the students read their police report, their press release, and it actually said all the entire scenario of everything that happened from beginning to end. And then they actually named their suspect.
Based on the evidence that was gathered, we believe that on Monday, January 19th, 2015, at approximately 15:40 hours, Mr. Rainbolt, principal at Binglong Elementary School, entered room E100 and stole Ms. Hill's Apple MacBook Pro. Thank you for your time, the CSI Forensics team for Binglong Elementary School.
We decided to take the students on a field trip to the police station so they could see firsthand what Lieutenant Lawhead and Officer Rhonda did on a daily basis, as well as all the different parts and jobs that involve public safety.
I think it's important because they got to see the officers again in real life, away from school, they're off campus, and to see that this exists within their city that they live. And it was a positive experience. They might have already come across police officers in a negative way, and this was something they could see. I could do this. I can work here. It's not that far from my house. This is a positive thing. To see the SWAT truck and to go into the SWAT vehicle and touch things and listen to detectives and be in the interrogation room, I think they will never forget this lesson because this was a real life thing. And I think you should have some kind of culminating activity at the end of each theme to keep the kids interested, plus to let them see real life adults doing this job and not just hear it from their teacher or see a video. They need to be there and they need to be immersed in that pathway.
Throughout their entire experience, the students were engaged and they didn't give up. Things didn't get easier, they got harder. So we started incorporating all the critical thinking and collaboration, communication, and the creativity from the very, very beginning. So the objective was to inspire, but in the end we ended up covering about 16 standards for sixth grade, as well as all the 21st century learning skills.
It is him, because look, out of the thing, because he has another,
he has flipped upside down.
You can't pick the wrong person.